Good morning, friends. Today again we are just going to discuss the computation of income under the head salary. In our last lecture, we learned that what is important to be considered while computing the income under the head salary. It means we learned that there should be relationship of master and servant. Master and servant between employer and the employee. We also learned what is the difference between wages and salary. It means there is no difference at all. Means wages and salaries, they are just used interchangeably. We also learned the accrual of salary. We also discussed something about the about the situation when a person is getting the salary from different employers. It means he's just working under different employers. All the computation would be done. So in continuation to the our earlier lectures, now we just try to learn what exactly is the employee salary structure. As far as employee salary structure is concerned, today we'll try to learn the basic things. I mean, how the salary structure is made. As far as the taxability part of different components which are just there in the salary structure, that is concerned, that we'll try to learn in the subsequent lectures. So to start with, we can say that the employee structure may consist of the following things. Number one, it may have basic pay, it may have DA, bonus, commission or fee or allowances. We'll just try to learn each one of the components. As I just told you earlier, that the detailed taxability of various components that will be discussed later on in the subsequent lectures. So the first component is, the first component under the employee salary structure is the basic pay. Basic pay is a very is one of the important components of the salary structure which an employer may give to the employee. And this basic pay may be given based on the basic qualities of an employee, and the basic qualities may be the qualifications. It may be based on his experience, his trainings, or his expertise, etc. in his employment. It means the basic pay would be determined based on that, these particular qualities of a person, and this basic pay is fully taxable under the Income Tax Act. The basic pay may be given in the sort of pay scale. It means the pay scale would be there. It may be, for example, the pay scale would be there, for example, 2000, then 100 rupees, then it may be 2500, then again 200 rupees, it may be 3000, like that. It means 100 rupees as an increment after 1 year. It means he will be getting 5 increments after 5 years. The salary would be 2500. In this fashion, the basic pay may be offered by the employer to the employee. And that basic pay is based on the qualification. There may be different pay scales. These are all the pay scales. This is one of the scales. The other scales, for example, may be in the range of 5000. Then there may be pay scales of 10000. That depends upon, again, the qualification experience of the employee. So this basic pay is fully taxable under the Income Tax Act. Next portion is, the next important portion is DA. DA means that the DLS allowance. That DLS allowance is in fact given by the employer to the employee so as to compensate him for inflation purposes. It means DA may be given to the employee so that he can compensate himself against the inflation, against the increase in the prices. And this DA part is generally linked with the basic pay, linked with the basic pay. It means that DA may be specified as some percentage. It will be based on some percentage of basic pay. Further, the determination of DA may be linked to the consumer price index, and this DA may be subject to revision on quarterly basis or on semi-annual basis like that. So ultimately, DA it becomes the part of the basic, means it is based on some percentage. It is to be reckoned at a percentage of basic, which is otherwise linked with the consumer price index. So this is second component of your this price structure, and DA is also taxable under the Income Tax Act as well as taxability is concerned. The third important component of the salary structure is bonus. Bonus is a payment which is paid by the employer, which is given by the employer to his employees, and this is out of the profit of the employer. So out of the profit, if quantum of profit is more, the employer may give more bonus. It means that is linked to the profit of the company, the profit of the employer. The employer, I just told you, the employer may be an individual, the employer may be a firm, employer may be company like that. So the bonus part, this part is also taxable, and that depends upon the profit of the employer. So this is also taxable under the Income Tax Act. Next is the next important component of salary structure is your commission or fee. Commission or fee, whatever name you can call it, this is given by the employer to the employee, and that being the extra payment which is given by the employer in respect of the extra work done by the employee. And this particular commission may be based on the performance of the employee. It may be based on the turnover of the company also. Some parameter may be fixed by the employer, and this is just linked with the extra work, extra effort which has been put by the employee for the attainment of the objectives which have been set by the employer. So this commission or fee is also taxable under the Income Tax Act. Next is allowances. This is the next important component of the salary structure. Allowance. Allowance, they are the monetary amounts. This is the monetary amount which is given by the employer to the employee for the purpose of meeting his personal expenses, or these monetary amounts may be given for the discharge of official purposes, means some official purposes may be given. So for both the purposes, these monetary allowances may be given. Generally, the monetary allowances which are given by the employer to the employee, they are taxable. Please mind it, remember it, they are taxable unless they are expressly exempted under the Income Tax Act. So based on that premises, we can say that the allowances are taxable. They may be fully taxable, they may be partly taxable, or they may be taxable either in the hands of employee, or they may be taxable in the hands of the employer, being the fringe benefit tax. What exactly is the treatment of these expenses, that we'll try to learn later on. I'll just show you what are those expenses which are there in that allowances. The allowances may be house rent allowances, that will just the taxability on this house rent allowance that we'll be discussing later on. They are being regulated and governed. In terms of subsection 13A of section 10 under rule 2A, and there are some special allowances. house rent allowance, in fact, the house rent allowance is the allowance which is given by the employer to the employee for the purpose of meeting his reimbursement, for the purpose of meeting his meeting the rent of the accommodation which he would require to undertake. It means some sort of allowance is given. For example, if a person is paying rent to the extent of 10,000 rupees in respect of the house which he has taken on rent, and the employer is giving some sort of amount so as a compensation, so that he can compensate him in respect of the payment which he has made for renting the house. So this is called house rent allowance. Apart from the house rent allowance, the other allowances which may be given by the employer to the employee may be special allowances, and the special allowances may be personal allowances, or they may be the allowances which may pertain to his official duties. What are the personal allowances? Because I just told you earlier that these allowances, what is the tax treatment of these allowances, to what extent they are exempted, or to what extent they are taxable, and under what circumstances they are taxable, or even if some exemption is there, to what extent they are exempted, and all the details that we shall be discussing later on. So for the time being, for the purpose of understanding, we can say that the allowances, basically the allowances consist of house rent allowances and special allowances, and the special allowances may again be split into two types. The personal allowances, may consist of the children education allowance, hostel allowance, transport allowance, outstation allowance, tribal area allowance, underground allowance, border area or remote area or difficult area allowances. Besides these personal allowances, there may be allowances also for official duties. These allowances may perhaps be given by the employer to the employee for the discharge of his official duties. So the various allowances which are given to the employee under this head are allowances granted to meet the cost of travel on tour or on transfer. When a person goes on tour or he is just transferred from one location to another, some allowances may be given. Daily allowance, then conveyance allowance. The conveyance allowance may be given for conveyance purpose from coming to office from his home, or for the purpose that may be given for the purpose of discharge of official duties. Helper allowance, academic allowance, research allowance, uniform allowance. So we'll be just discussing all these allowances in detail and the tax treatment later on. The other form of allowance may be a foreign allowance, which is just generally given to the employees which are rendering their services outside India. Then other allowances which may also be of personal nature may be your city compensatory allowance, CCA, cash allowance, split duty allowance, overtime allowance, medical allowance, servant allowance, tiffin allowance, deputation allowance, etc. So these are the allowances which may also be given to the employee by the employer, and they also form the part of the salary structure. Now the next important component of the salary structure is perquisites. Now what are the perquisites? In fact, the perquisite is the casual payment, you can say it is a casual payment, or it may be fee or a profit which may be given by the employer to the employee apart from the salary. It means besides the salary, the employer may be getting some casual payment or a fee or a profit, or in other words, or in simple way, we can say these perquisites, they are the benefits. They are the benefits or the facilities which an employee gets from the employer. Now, with a view to tax the perquisite in the hands of the employee, two things are very important. Number one, the employee should get these benefits, these benefits or facilities as a part of his employment. It means as a right, he should get the benefits. Means by virtue of his position in the office, by virtue of his employment there, he should get these facilities from the employer on a regular basis as a right. Means he has got a right to receive the benefits. Number two, these benefits or these facilities should be properly authorized by the employer. It means it should not be something which is given voluntarily by the employer to the employee. Rather, the employee should be getting these facilities or these benefits by virtue of his terms of employment, by virtue of his right. If a person gets some benefits or the facilities, not as a right, but the employer voluntarily gives him something on some occasional basis, then it cannot be termed as a perquisite to be taxable in the hands of the employer. It means the legal issue origin from the employer, it should be properly authorized by the employer, only then we can say that is a perquisite which is taxable in the hands of employer. Means that would be perquisites within that meaning. So what are the perquisites and what exactly is included in the perquisites? We can say the perquisites may include the value of any rent-free accommodation provided to the SSC by the employer. It may be the value of any concession in the matter of rent in respect of accommodation provided to the SSC by the employer. It may be, the first is the rent-free accommodation which may be given by the employer to the SSC to his employee. It is a perquisite. Second may be the some concession may be given by the employer to his employee in respect of the accommodation which has been provided by the employer to his employee. Or some gardener facility, he might have given some gardener or a watchman or sweeper, any other servant may be given by the employer to the employee, that may come under the head perquisite. Gas or electricity or water may have been supplied by the employer to the employee by virtue of, and this gas, electricity, water, these are the facilities which an employer is getting by virtue of his terms of employment. Education facility may be there, which may be provided. Similarly, payment by the employer on behalf of the employee, or the payment of insurance premium on behalf of the employee. These are some of the examples of the perquisites. The taxability of these perquisites, that we shall be discussing later on. So these are the things which are included in the term perquisites. Now, similarly, there may be medical facility also. Medical facility might have been provided by the employer to the employee, and this medical facility may be in the form of the hospitals which may be owned by the employer, or he may give this medical facility in the hospitals which may be owned by some government hospitals or some authorized hospital or something like that. So leave, travel, concession, LTC or any other field benefit. So these are some of the examples, some of the types of the facilities are the benefits which may be given or rendered by the employer to the employees, and these are called the perquisites. Next component of the salary structure is the retirement benefit. When a person gets retired from his job, some benefits are given, some benefits are given which are called the retirement benefits, and these retirement benefits are given by the employer to his employee in appreciation of the past services rendered by the employee. And these retirement benefits may be, they may include, for example, provident fund, gratuity, leave encashment, it may be pension, commuted pension, etc. So these are the retirement benefits which are given by the employer to the employee. The next important thing is the advance salary. Advance salary is something which may be given by the employer to the employee. As you know, that salary is taxed on due basis or receipt basis, whichever is earlier. It is possible that sometimes the employee may desire some advance salary from the employer. Now, what could be the treatment of this advance salary? How that advanced salary would be treated, we just try to learn it through an example. For example, Mr. S is working with ABC Limited and he is getting 20,000 rupees per month as a salary. And he receives the bonus of rupees 5,000 in October 2006 and various allowances of rupees 5,000 per month. In the month of March 2007, means last month of the financial year, previous year, 2006-2007, he requests his employer to pay his salary for the month of April and May 2007 for medical treatment of his wife. So in this case, he is demanding some salary in advance. Means he wants advance salary, which will otherwise be payable to him in the month of April and May. So how that treatment would be given, how it would be taxable, how it would be computed his total income, that we just try to see. So in this case, the gross salary would be made like that. Basic pay, basic salary would be 20,000 multiplied by 12 because he is getting 20,000 rupees salary per month and he is getting salary for 12 months. The number of period 5 is getting 12. So 2,40,000 is a salary. Bonus he is getting 5,000 rupees and allowances, other allowances are getting, he is getting 5,000 rupees per month. For 12 months the allowances would be 60,000. And this is the portion which needs your attention. Here he is getting the advance salary for April and May. In this case, the advance salary would be taxable. It means that would be added up in his total income under that salary. So he is getting it. But however, for the next year, for the succeeding year, this particular amount will not be added up in the salary for the previous year 2007-2008. So this is the way we can club the salary, this advance salary, under the other salary which is getting. However, the next question comes, what is the difference between salary, advance salary and advance against salary? So in this case we have seen that he has demanded the advance salary, which has not, means he has demanded the advance salary for the month of April and May. Means for April and May he has not worked and he is just getting, he wants a salary in advance. So that is the advance salary. Now the question is, what is advance against salary? In fact, the advance against salary is a loan. Advance against salary is against salary. That is a loan. So the treatment would be given like a loan. In this case, if he is getting the advance against salary, it means he is not demanding the salary. He wants a advance against salary for the month, in the month of March. So in this case, this advance which he has taken against salary, it will not be taxed, it will be treated as a loan. I think now the difference between salary, advance salary and advance against salary would be quite clear. So as far as the tax treatment of various allowances, perquisites and other components are concerned, that we will be discussing in our next class. Thank you very much.